I remember going to church as an adult, right, for the first time when I started going to church. And I would walk in, and the pastor was like, he said, "I want you to pray with your neighbor." And I'm like, "Well, my neighbor don't go to this church. I don't know if you mean. You want me to call my neighbor on the phone? That's creepy. I ain't going to do that." Right, then they explained to me, right, your neighbor is a person sitting next to you. Listen, I'm brand new at this Christian stuff. I didn't even know you're supposed to pray out loud, let alone with this lady. I don't even know this lady. What am I supposed to pray about? Lord, help these bumps go down on this lady's face. I don't know what to pray about. I don't know what I'm supposed to pray about, right? She went first. She was praying all good, and she must have been John the Baptist's little sister or something. Praying. She was like, "Dear Heavenly Father, you said in your word in the 6th chapter, the third verse of the book of Matthew, the 601st word on page 1248. Lord, you said, but seek, S is in search, E is in everywhere, E is in excellent, K is in kingdom. You're the Alpha, Nisi, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha." I'm thinking, man, she even know his nicknames. Now it's my turn to pray, right? But I don't got the spiritual vocabulary to just, but I'm not gonna let her outpray me. So I'm like, "Okay, God, first of all, you are good people. You know, you are good, Lord. You are good. You are good to the last drop, Lord. Because, Lord, I just gotta obey my thirst, Lord. You know, because choosy moms choose Jesus. So, Lord, because. No, as the rocket's red glare, Lord, it gave proof to the night, Lord. I believe I could fly, amen."
Hi, welcome to Darkwood Brew. I'm Eric Elnis, your host, and Darkwood Brew is that place where ancient Christian mystical practice is blended with modern interactive web technology, world-class jazz, arts, biblical scholarship, and, well, you never know exactly what's going to happen. Do you have a hard time with prayer? Do you feel like you have the right language? Or do you know some people who just seem to have it all down and they know God by God's nicknames? It's difficult, isn't it? Especially in a modern era where we know the universe is a pretty vast place. Could there be a God who's even out there and listening to us? Yet there are some who say that if there is no possibility of connection with God, that all religion is bunk. It's just a waste of time. And yet, if there is a possibility of connection with God, then it's the most important thing we'll ever do. We're starting a new series this evening at Darkwood Brew called Listen, Hearing That Small, Still Small Voice and Finding Your Own. During the series, we've invited 6 recognized leaders in Christianity, including tonight's Bishop Yvette Flunder from the City of Refuge, to talk about their own inner spiritual path, their challenges, how do they know it's God speaking, not the pizza they just ate. We've got an amazing series lined up over this next few weeks. We're looking forward to you joining us, including tonight for Yvette Flunder.
Well, I'm not really sure why you're here, Ron. I know I haven't exactly been the model citizen since I got here, but considering how things have been going for me lately, I thought I was doing pretty well.
And I also find it kind of discouraging that you seem to think that I'm in need of some sort of spiritual guidance or what have you, so much so that you're willing to disregard the fact that I don't believe in any of this stuff at all.
Well, I didn't mean to discourage you.
Yeah, I find it kind of insulting.
Can I say something here? Sammy asked me to come talk to you because it's her opinion that you're not going to find what you're looking for the way you've been looking for it.
And how would she know?
But I'm really not here to try to get you to do anything or to try to get you to believe in anything. And I'll tell you the same thing I told her, which is that as far as I'm concerned, the only way she can help you is by her example, by trying to be a model for you in the way she lives her life. And that doesn't mean she's supposed to be a saint either, if that's what you're smiling about.
I didn't realize I was smiling.
You know, Terry, a lot of people come to see me with all kinds of problems. Drugs, alcohol, marital problems, sexual problems.
Great job you have, man.
Well, I like it. Because even in this little town, I really feel like what I do is very connected with the real center of people's lives. I'm not saying I'm always Mr. Effective, but I don't feel like my life is off to the side of what's important. I don't feel that my happiness and comfort are based on closing my eyes to trouble within myself or trouble in other people. I don't feel like a negligible little scrap floating around in some kind of empty void with no sense of connectedness to anything around me except by virtue of whatever little philosophies I can scrape together on my own.
Well?
Can I ask you, Terry, do you think your life is important?
You mean like me personally, like my individual life?
Yeah.
I'm not really sure. What do you mean? I mean, it's important to me, I guess, and like to my, you know, the people who care about me.
But do you think it's important? Do you think it's important in the scheme of things, not just because it's yours or because you're somebody's brother? Because I really don't get the impression that you do.
I don't particularly think that anybody's life has any particular importance besides whatever, you know, like whatever we arbitrarily give it, which is fine. I mean, you know, we might as well. I mean, I think my life is important as anybody else's. I don't know, Rod. A lot of what you're saying has real appeal to me. You know, the stuff they told us when we were kids. But, you know, I don't want to believe in something or not believe in it because I might feel bad. I want to believe in it or not believe in it because I think it's true or not. Yeah, I mean, I want to think that my life is important, that it's connected to something important.
Well, isn't there any way for you to believe that without calling it God or religion or whatever term it is that you object to?
Yeah, I believe that.
The sense of connectedness, I think, is the key to that. That we have a whole bunch of folks that I know of that are out there seeking that connectedness to somebody who's listening, somebody who they can connect with. And yet, when they actually go out seeking that connection, they don't believe that they'll actually make that connection, that God is listening, that God is connecting with them. And that's kind of what's behind this whole series, is where is that cave? Where can you intentionally go about looking for that connection and believing and expecting it to be there?
Yeah.
To have a response.
You mentioned cave. What do you mean by cave? Where's that cave? Yeah. Where'd that come from?
That came from the Elijah text. It's about Elijah when he's trapped and he thinks that his only option is to die. This is a biblical story in the Old Testament. And so he runs off and he goes and hides in a cave and wants to die because he thinks they're going to kill him anyway and God is nowhere in sight. So he intentionally goes out looking for God to either say, end this or fix it.
Ah, oh, I think I remember that text. It was like 1 Kings 19, verses 6 through 9 through 16, I think. Yeah.
Handy that's our new one.
Just got it memorized, you know, so yeah. But that is our central passage. this evening we'll be getting to a little later. It's pretty interesting one, and actually there's a very famous story about this cave that Elijah goes to, because he's the second person who's been to this cave in the Bible. The first one is Moses.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and Moses you know, says that he goes there to meet God. He wants to see God face to face, and God says, well, you know, that's not really a good idea. It might kill you. And he says, well, I'm tired of all this, you know, smoke and clouds and stuff. You know, I want to see you face to face. So finally God says, okay, you know, I'll put my hand right over your face, and I'll walk by. And then as soon as I've walked by, then you can see me. And it's just wild. I mean, story. It's really deep mythological imagination going on here. But so it says that he did see God. He saw God's back. But the Hebrew is actually plural. They're backs, and it's dual, meaning two things of equal proportion. He saw God's backs. Now, what do you suppose that would mean? It's like the humor, I think, is
I'm
just great.
Make you say that.
Yeah, yeah. God's basically saying, you want it clarity? You want it to be perfectly clear? Well, you can. Well, we have phrases for that.
I think it's like the early version of talk to the hand.
Talk to the hand. Something like that. Yeah, yeah. I think we got a picture of that someplace too. Yeah, check out this. Let's put that up on the screen. Those Renaissance writer. In case you didn't get the joke there. There's what Elijah saw at Mount Horeb there. Yeah. Anyway, so we asked a question this week.
We did. Yeah. Because this was our text, we were thinking about where is it that you go to intentionally seek out God and actually expect to have a response. We had several different responses, mostly in the area of dancing and music. The question of the week was, the Hebrew prophet Elijah sought God in a cave, and God met him there. Where is your cave? Where does God show up for you?
So what did we get?
So we had music is my thin place, is what Maureen Howland says. And then we have anywhere a choir is singing. And there were several other passages like Sylvia's there that speak to music and dancing and a kind of connection through sound and audio in that sense. So there is that. And, you know, you can get lost in music, but I sometimes I wonder if that's where God finds you and as you're seeking God. So it's kind of, you get lost in that.
Remember Augustine once said, when you sing, you pray twice. You know, I think that's true. And incidentally, we've just changed the music on our countdown timer before the show begins. It's actually a Chuck Moronic song called Listen. And that's actually part of what we get the title of the series from, is actually his song. Listen, the Lord's about to speak now. So.
Well, that was handy, too, for this series.
Yeah.
Yeah. Other places that people mention, Leslie Morrell and John Longard talk about their family and their friends. Leslie says, in the kindness of others, in my kids, in hindsight, which is helpful, on a good run or a swim or just before I wake up in the morning. And John concurs and says, in my front yard, when I listen to my neighbors to get a sense as to what God is up to in their lives and how I can assist God in what God is doing.
That's beautiful. You know, I met John at the Wild Goose Festival this last summer,
and
he was actually on sabbatical and using Darkwood Brew as his kind of worshipful time. So if you're out there, John, good to see you.
Yeah. Another place was in gardening and in nature. We have all kinds of folks that talk about what it's like to kind of have that mountaintop experience, but even more closely in the garden or just outside your front door on your porch. We had Davida Crabtree says, digging in the dirt of my garden gets me to reflect pretty deeply about life and earth and faith. If I find myself pruning, it often signals a need to get rid of something. If I'm weeding, it's too often a metaphor for something else I'm struggling with. Planting, watering, sheltering, harvesting, it all gets me in a closer relationship with those who make our eating possible through their labor. And it's not my only place where God appears, but a major one.
I think I've had similar experiences out in the garden. I don't think the plants would have, if they could speak, if they would say they have a God experience through my tending them. Though I've got kind of a black thumb. Pretty much anything dies under my control.
But. My plant's a little weepy in my office these days, too. So. Another whole section, I think, which is one that I would concur with, is in that sense of doubt and uncertainty, that even in the midst of that, in what one person actually calls the pit, David Lohr, in one of his responses says, often in the pit, as described in many Psalms. In fact, I think many of us meet Jesus there for the first time. So that whole sense of doubt and insecurity, is a place where often we most need God, so we seek God out.
Mm. Yeah, that's a good point. And it seems like, you know, with all that uncertainty, it's kind of a way of protecting our free will, too. If it was all just bright neon signs saying, here's what my will is, I mean, what would we do? What choice would we have? But, you know, given that it's hard, it's difficult to pursue this connection thing, you know, and it's uncertain. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to really want the connection in order to, I think, you really kind of make our way into it. I mean, not that it's all about us and our wanting, but I think that sometimes, you know, I like the struggle. Then I can choose whether, do I really want to hear from God, or am I going to try to make it on my own for a while until I stumble and fall?
Well, and I think that's half the battle, right, is learning to expect that God will answer. You first have to deal with your fear of what if God actually does. I mean, that's a pretty scary place to be. But what Diana Butler Bass answered us back, and I loved her response. Her response was United Airlines.
I know she spends a lot of time in that cave.
She does.
Well, she's always, her frequent flyer mileage must be huge.
And you've been spending a lot of time in that cave recently. You've been out traveling.
My frequent flyer mileage is now racking up too, yes. For those of you just...
Did you meet God there? Was it
not in the plane? No. actually, but if you're going to, Qantas Airlines is a good place to do that. I think I spent a lot of time on Qantas, flying to the land down under in Australia. In fact, this was my route map for this 3-week speaking tour. You know, bear in mind Australia is like as big as the United States virtually, and it was just a lot of getting around Australia. Went to Melbourne and to Perth on the west, then to Darwin in the north, and back to Melbourne, then over to Canberra, and then to Adelaide, and then Sydney, and I was then back. So it was a lot.
Nothing.
Yeah, it was a great tour, though. I met a lot of really great people and had some really great food as well. I bit a crocodile. It did not bite me. There it
nice.
Is. That's actually crocodile. I saw all kinds of wildlife like this down hopping down the road, and I pardon vegetarians, but I also ate one of some of that too. I should be showing that. Please don't send any cards or letters. But the Australian government actually is urging people to do that. It's supposed to be healthy. It's native to the end. It's also overpopulated in some areas.
Just much like our deer here.
Yeah, that's right. If you'd like to read about my travels, more than just eating, actually meeting up with Christian leaders from around the country and various networks with the Uniting Church of Australia and Progressive Christian Networks. You can read about it if you go to the countrysideucc.org website. You'll see a little icon that says Eric in Australia. countrysideucc.org. That's my home church in Omaha. And you can read all about that tour. Really interesting. Really great people. It's always amazing when you get out and about and you see people who are just doing stuff that are never make the headlines. Hmm. And yet they're just doing these mind-blowing things, living these lives of courage and faith and witness, and it's pretty cool.
And we have lots of small groups and viewers from there. It must have been nice to put names to faces.
Yes, it was. I met up with Darkwood Brew viewers there, and also people who had read the Phoenix Affirmations book that I wrote several years ago, and that was very satisfying. But yeah, Australia is our fifth highest viewership outside the United States. So come
so
on,
next time invite
we need
me.
More. Yeah,
I'll come next time.
That's right. So anyway.
Yeah. I'm glad you're back.
I'm glad to be back, too. As Dorothy says, there's no place like home, and that's very true, even though it was a great tour. Great to see you again, too. So, well, we want to transition. We're going to be seeing Bishop Yvette Flunder with a really, really awesome church called the City of Refuge in the Bay Area, and she'll be up next. But we want to bring back something that we kind of faded out. I don't even know why it slipped out of our what we were doing here, but we had earlier been taking a couple minutes just simply to center ourselves using music, actually, as that cave that we enter. And we want to invite you to ask yourself in the next couple minutes, just to kind of take a couple deep breaths, and then ask yourself, is there a question or a need that's particular to you that if you could find insight from beyond yourself or from a higher power, that you would really like that and perhaps need that? Something not a question that's not too big, like what's the meaning of life, but something very specific to your own situation. Let's simply take a deep breath in, let it out slowly, and as music plays, consider that question Perhaps we'll find insight tonight, or something tonight will help set you on a path to finding a response to that very question. Well, it's good to have Yvette Flunder with us with City of Refuge, and glad you could join us tonight, Yvette.
I'm glad to be here. Can you hear me well?
I can hear you very well. Yeah, you're coming in loud and clear. Yvette, you are with the City of Refuge, and that is a fascinating church. I was wondering if maybe you could tell, for those who may not be familiar with your church, could you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I'm the happy pastor. And I say servant leader of City of Refuge United Church of Christ in San Francisco. And we are a little bit better than 22 years old. And we are an inner city church right in the heart of San Francisco. And our outreach is often to folks who are most marginalized by church and society. So we have active ministry to people who are in recovery, people who are homeless, people who are from the LGBT community, people who are recovering from very conservative church burns. Hmm. And we have a reestablished church and planted church similar to City of Refuge in several states in the United States, as well as three countries in Africa and in Mexico. So we have a fellowship of churches now called the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries.
Wow, that's a pretty big network of folks. I noticed, on your site you call yourselves a Baptimethicostal community. what is that?
Well, most of us emerged from the Baptist, Methodist, and Pentecostal traditions. Very interracial, but most of us did emerge from those traditions. And consequently, Methodist-Baptist-Costal is the best way to describe the celebration freestyle worship. We have a B3 organ, and a lead and bass guitar, and a full drum set, and lots of tambourines. Maybe that's helpful.
Sounds like a place I'd like to spend some time. B3 is the best organ there is.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it sounds a lot like your church is operating in what we might call we've been calling a convergence mode. We've been talking, and people like Brian McLaren and so forth talking about people who have kind of been in one side of the theological swimming pool or another, and who have kind of left their native tradition, are looking for faith in a new way, and kind of finding each other and sharing gifts out there. What are some of the gifts that you bring to the Baptimethicostal church? What comes out of the tradition that you left behind that you continue to value?
Well, I think convergence is a good type of what it is that we're experiencing, especially if we're talking about sort of like an evangelical, Catholic, stream consistently coming together. But I like to think of it as reformation, because I think that the Christian churches do a reformation in many ways. And this reformation basically is, what is the baby and what is the bathwater? And some of our folks have determined that we want to hold on to the cultural realities of worship and community and not lose that, because that's the glue that binds our hearts together. Fellowship is the binding principle that binds our hearts together. But we need to lose the oppressive theology that's often been a part of that. And so we had to create a hybrid that kept the sound and the style and the heart of the communities that we emerged from sans the oppressive theologies that were once a part of that reality.
And what would you say is the role of the Holy Spirit in your church?
An interesting panel that I was on in the not too recent past, we did a lot of proof texting about, at least my colleagues did, about what the Bible says about this and the Bible says about that. And I did something with them that I often do in the classes that I teach in seminary. I took my Bible and I put it on the lectern and I said, so let's see what the Bible says. And we waited patiently for the Bible to say something. And the Bible said absolutely nothing, of course. I said to them that what the Bible says is definitively determined by the interpreter and by the lenses of the interpreter, which is, in my thinking, why the Holy Spirit's movement is so vital in the lives of people who are Spirit-led and Spirit-filled. Because I think the only way we will really know what the Spirit is saying to the church is for us to hear from the Holy Spirit. That way, the Word of God is not bound by people's words about God. Essentially, I am not, as Peter Gomes coined the phrase, bibliolatry. I don't worship the book. I worship the God of the book. And the God of the book has to be interpreted to people through and by the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. Reminds me of somebody once observed that in the creation of the canon originally, that their purpose, none of the criteria that was used to choose texts from the Bible were that they were the inerrant word of God, but rather, I mean, they would have thought that was ludicrous, and they actually chose texts to try to point us towards God, beyond the text, towards a living relationship with God. Yeah.
So, well, I'd like to say that the Apostle Paul, when he was sending essentially emails from prison, he did not have any intent that we were going to think that everything he said was God.
Yeah, do you think he even would have written anything if he thought that later it would be lifted up, you know, as the inerrant word of God, with these hastily written in times of conflict? And absolutely. I think that's probably why Jesus, you know, what records do we have of Jesus writing anything? Jesus was smart. It's like these people will kill each other if they have if something they can count as the literal inerrant word.
Yeah. Right.
So how do you, you know, if the Holy Spirit is a central piece of this, how do we in the modern world where we have appropriate skepticism about such things? We know there are chemical influences in our bodies from the pizza or the coffee and those kind of, how do we, or how do you discern whether it's God speaking or just the pizza you just ate? Do you have any kind of general rules of thumb that you use?
I think that's a very good question, because our tendency in religious pursuit is to concretize God and to come up with some clear, specific way. You know, we love the science, and we want religion to have science. The truth of the matter is our walk with God, thanks be to God, always is mystery. And I love that. I think that that's important. However, I'm an African in America, you know, and I believe in something that my foremothers and forefathers called knowing. Knowing is that deep sense of assurance, something that the song poet called blessed assurance. And hearing from God and receiving the witness in my spirit that I have heard from God is a knowing that I cannot even really give words to. I believe that the way that the Spirit works with us and definitively makes clear to us what is God or what God is saying to us comes from something deeper even than words can connect to. I think that the litmus test can often be whether or not what it is that we're hearing is consistent with the nature of the God of our understanding. I watch that often when people tell me, well, God told me to tell you thus and so, or God said thus and so. I say, well, honey, that's you, baby. That's not God. Now, it's important, but I think that the deeper truth is that the Spirit of God in us, which is still mystery in many ways to me, even as a Pentecostal, which is my background, I thank God for knowing something that is deep inside that gives me that blessed assurance that I have definitively heard from God.
Mm, that's great. Do you have any particular practices you engage in to try to put yourself in a place of knowing?
Well, I like and enjoy private time. You know, I like your analogy of the cave and the conversation that has come from many of the sisters and brothers with regard to where that place is for them. Personal time is not easy often for the people that I serve, and it is not has not always been easy for me, because in the cave with you are always your demons, whatever your demons are, your fears, your guilt, your shame. So quiet times of prayer and meditation, personal hangout time with God, also is personal hangout time for lots of other things that come in the cave with you. And so I have learned that, but the old folks in my community used to say, steal away. They would say, steal away to Jesus. I have learned that that personal time is also a time of embracing my fears and managing my fears, managing my doubt. That's real godly time for me. Mm. That's what generally happens when I am in an alone place. And I can be in a room full of people and still go into that place where I have to fully see myself and be with myself and with my God. And here's the truth, Eric. None of us can ever see ourselves with our human eyes. We can see a reflection of ourselves in a mirror, but we can't see ourselves because mirrors lie. You know, some of them make you look skinny and some of them make you look fat.
I want one of those former kind.
But when we look inward, then we can see ourselves for real, internally, and touch our God inwardly, because that's where real relationship with God exists. So I found myself practicing that even when I'm in a room full of people. I go in there and go and embrace my fears, embrace my demons. Kind of reminds me of that movie, A Beautiful Mind, with Russell Crowe playing John Nash, and what he had to do with his schizophrenia. He had to sort of wave at it and acknowledge its presence and simultaneously move into the greatness that was his destiny in God.
Yeah, that's beautiful. That reminds me of one of those, I think it was a Jungian principle that in a dream, if a monster appears, if you will actually not, if you'll just face it and not run away, that it will become your friend. And I like what you're saying about, it sounds like there's a lot of continuity between getting to knowing God and knowing self. You know, reminds me of Augustine in the 4th century. He said, the path to knowing God and the path to knowing yourself is the same path.
Absolutely. Yeah. Embracing your fear in many ways is knowing God. Yeah. Embracing yourself, embracing the darkness is in many ways the real locus of deep relationship with God.
Maybe that's why the most oft phrase in the whole Hebrew scriptures is Al Tira, do not fear, do not fear. That's good. Well, we're going to take a break and come back to you in a moment. coming up next, we have our Numa passage of Elijah standing in that cave where God had revealed God's backsides to Moses years earlier. So stay with us. We're going to be putting up the passage on the screen, but if you have a Bible and want to follow along too, we're going to be reading this. It's in a practice we call Numa Divina, which is related to the ancient Lectio Divina, where you're going to hear the passage, you also see it on the screen, and just simply try to let the passage sink in and find the verse that really kind of raises itself up off the screen or the book. For you, we'll be, after the reading, we'll be calling for you to indicate which passage kind of lifted itself off for you in the poll. Our social media coordinator, Morris Jones, will be putting up on the live chat a little vote here, blue link, and then in the coffee house we've got our Numa Divina sheets. You'll be putting just make big letters or big numbers on here. We'll be calling for that verse, and then later in the episode, I will be reflecting on that verse, and we'll also give Yvette Flunder a chance to comment on it if she cares to as well. So let's hear from 1 Kings chapter 19, verses 9 through 16.
At that place he came to a cave and spent the night there. Then the word of the Lord came to him, saying, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." He said, "Go out and stand on the mountain before the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." Now there was a great wind, so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire, and after the fire, a sound of sheer silence. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He answered, I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away. Then the Lord said to him, Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. When you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael of Aram. Also, you shall anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king over Israel. And you shall anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, of Abel-Meholah, as prophet in your place.
Was the verse that lifted itself off up in your internal cave there. If you will put that, record that in the social chat, and if you will write it down, we'll be back in 30 seconds with the results and more from Yvette Flunder. What did we find on the internet?
Well, at the last refresh, we have a split equally, verses 12 and verse 13. And I'll do a quick refresh here.
And, okay, we've got...
confirm... What?
12.
Yes, verses 12 and 13.
Okay, so after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire, the sound of sheer silence. That's verse 12. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Then there came a voice to him that said, What are you doing here, Elijah? That's the second one. Okay.
Yes.
How about in the coffee house? Where would we have? I'm seeing lots and lots of 12s. I've seen 11 and 13, but definitely it's a 12 here. Okay. Well, I guess that will break the tie. Then we'll go with verse 12.
12. Sounds good.
Then, and we'll see if Yvette Flunder would like to comment on it. But one way or the other, I'll have a little something to say about that, too. That's a fascinating verse. There's some fascinating Hebrew actually underlying that particular verse. So thanks. Well, and if you want to ask a question of Yvette as we during our talk, I'd indicate that online too. Morris will be tracking that. So let's go back to Yvette now. Good to have you back with us.
Oh, good to be back.
Oh, is sound up in here?
Okay. Can you hear me?
Okay, we can't hear you in the. Okay, we got you. Just okay. The sound wasn't up in the room. So did you? I don't know if you heard. The verse 12 was kind of what people resonated with. That the sound, not in the earthquake or the fire, but in the sound of sheer silence. And we always like to offer the Skype guest a chance to comment on that if they like. But there's no requirement that you do so. or if you'd like to comment on another verse from that passage that kind of lifted itself off the page for you.
Well, yes, I definitely resonate with how God moves in silence and the importance of a prayer being more listening than pyrotechnics, you know. and I believe that that's the heart of that passage. It is ours to hear from God. And I think that oftentimes as human beings, when we look for a sign, we always want something that is in the realm of dramatic, you know, that blesses me. I tell you, the passage that I think is closest to my heart is probably an unlikely one to come up, and that is in verse 16, primarily because what was happening to Elijah, which he didn't really understand when he went in the cave, is transition. He was being moved along and being called by God to anoint another king, and also to name his successor.
Yes, pretty interesting.
His entire experience was a succession plan.
Yeah.
And I suspect, like Elijah, many people who are feeling that kind of shift and change often have a need to go to a place that is private to hear from God. Let me say it another way. There are a whole lot of us that are getting a message to do something different, do it differently. And it comes in a still small voice.
Yeah. That's a good point, you know, about that transition and calling to do something different, because it seems like what's being asked here is him to add something to his life, that is to go and anoint these kings, but also then to take something out of his life as well. It's like, okay, now this whole role that you've served is now going to be handed on to another. And I wonder how oftentimes we come before God and are asking, we want this, we want this, but how many times do we come and say, well, and how about what do you want me to let go of? You
know, right, and that's real prayer.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. It also seems to me that in that verse, where he's asked, and so he's called to name the new king over Israel and Aram, that this would be something that he would not feel particularly up to, to name these kings. I mean everybody's standing around saying, well, who are you to do this? And it seems like a lot of times, isn't it that God seems, when we sense that pull, it almost feels like a compliment that's too high for us, like, well, we're not capable of that.
Right, that's right. And I think he was experiencing some of that anyway, because of all of the dysfunction among the people that he lifted up in his prayer time. They won't do this and they won't do that, and they won't hear and they won't listen. And essentially they won't listen to me and what it is that I'm saying. But in the midst of his time of feeling so disconnected as a leader, a spiritual leader, and almost an oracle to the people of God, simultaneously, God was placing in him the next steps for his people and what was to happen. And I'm sure that he felt that it shouldn't come from him, given the way that they were receiving him. But it was him that was called to speak into the lives of his people what the next step should be.
Yeah. So do you suppose that he just kind of downloaded that as an insight, and bam, it's there, and now he's just going to go off and do this, or did you think that this story might be pointing towards a series of kind of confirmations, or how does that work? You get this really high call that's going to be risky too, because there's other people who probably want to be king, so he's going to it's going to involve him in risking his life, doing something he probably doesn't feel too qualified for.
I like the analogy that you gave, because I think the passage that includes Moses' experience in the cave is analogous to this, because Moses was at that point also, because he had just really gotten tired of the people complaining in the telling of his story, and went into a cave and sort of gave God an ultimatum. If you don't tell me what to do next, I am not going back down there and dealing with those hard-headed people, not another day.
Yes.
And I want to see you. I want an affirmation that you are with me, that you are called me, that you are using me. And I think it's probably safe to say, Eric, that whenever any of us are prophetically called to do something, we first have to step through the chasm of doubt. As old folks, my old folks used to say, it takes faith to step out on nothing and believe until something is there. And Moses had that experience. And then God revealed God's self to Moses. And I love the analogy, I really do, that where God says, you can't see my face, but I'm going to show you my backside. And I like to say often that Moses wanted to see where God was going. God revealed to Moses where God had been. If you can see where I have been, essentially, if you can see what I have done, it will give you faith to believe what I said I will do. Something very powerful happened for him when he saw God's hinder part, as the King James calls the hinder part. And he came down off the mountain with faith to go forward and to take the people forward. So I think there's a connection. I think real prophetic leadership is rooted often in fear and doubt. And because we have fear and doubt doesn't mean that we are not called to do the work. Courage, by definition, doesn't mean that we are not afraid.
Yeah,
it means that we do it whether we're afraid or not.
Yeah, those are really great points. I think, you know, so oftentimes Christianity has devolved into this thing like if we only ever should offer God our praise, and yet so oftentimes in the Bible, these great leaders are offering God their rage as well. It's like, hey, wait a minute, what's going on here? You know, Elijah, I'm the only one left, I think, or Jeremiah, you know, oh, you've deceived me, or actually the Hebrew is closer, you've screwed me. And I've been literally, no, I'm serious. That's literally the best translation of the word there. You know, he's like, hey, come on, you know, and yet we say, oh, no, you should only ever offer God your praise.
Right.
I mean, come
right.
on.
That's right. No, you have to get mad sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, I think God dwells in our emotions, particularly when they're authentic, when they're real. It doesn't do any service to our relationship to God or to others if we're pretending that we are feeling something that we're not.
That's right. I think maybe God counts that as a sign of faith, that we
yes.
we have faith that we can actually be honest with God, that we have faith that God isn't going to, you know, hit the cosmic smite button because we've expressed our honesty, and maybe even faith
right.
that we think that God is listening and might actually change, you know, course, or at least help us change course.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
I agree. Faith and covenant.
Yeah.
And relationship.
That's right. Yeah.
Yes.
Well, Morris, do we have a question from the internet crowd?
Wow. So much. There's a lot of discussion,
yeah.
and I know you like for me to ask only one.
Well, it's just,
wow.
we could go on till 9 o'clock tonight if we.
Yvette, wow, so much. Religion that you can feel, making prophetic leadership, decisions from a place where you know, recognizing doubt and fear, the humanity of doubt and fear. Okay, here's the question. And I will. Here's the question that the online community is discussing. What are or were some of the theologies that Yvette, your community or the church found repressive and helped marginalize your parish church and other parish churches? That is the question. And here's another one that is being discussed online. What are some of the disciplines that you see assist in listening?
Okay. So I think we're going to give her a choice. One or the other.
You can tackle either one. There's been a lot of discussion. This is wonderful. Thank you.
All right. I probably should tackle the first one because it's huge for our community. And again, City of Refuge and the many churches that have been born out of and associate with us in the Fellowship of Affirming Ministries have that similarity. We come from conservative theological backgrounds, but we have, in our search for fellowship, often when we got into other environments that we felt were where we really are theologically, we're culturally so different, so polar from where we came from and still didn't feel like home. So the question of what was theologically oppressive, there were the confession that we are not biblical literalists, the confession that we read the text through liberation lenses, the doctrines of radical inclusion and extravagant grace and relentless hospitality that make the table of God accessible to all people, to include people who are in recovery, people who are LGBT, people from the prison population, homeless population, different definitions of sin and what that really means. So many different things that were the hot button items, the hot potato items that made people feel that they didn't have a seat at the table, that they could be a part of the kingdom of God. We revisit constantly those realities. We revisit, to your point, Eric, the canonization of the text. Why our canon? You know, why we've had the courage to humanize the Bible writers and to humanize the interpreters, historical interpreters. We have to look back at oppression of women, oppression of people of color, empire in our government, several things that were just off limits to people who just took the word of their teachers. Mm-hmm. So those have been huge, huge processes for my Methodist-Baptist people, as they have been for me. And so we had to come to personal relationship with God as a priority, because when someone destabilizes the Bible or destabilizes the cultural interpretations, historical cultural interpretations of the Bible, you need something to hang on to. Mm. And what we're left with sometime at the end of the day is holding on to our relationship, our deep relationship with God. There's a song from a play that's called The Naked Man that says, there is no map for where we're going, but we're not lost. Hmm. We're here.
Oh, that's beautiful. Yeah.
I believe that with all my heart.
Yes, absolutely. I think you really touch on an important part that we're seeing in this kind of convergence that's happening, too. You have one tradition that's basically said, you replace a relationship with a paper pope, the Bible, you know, and that as the inerrant, you know, literal word of God in some way that you can just simply get it off of a book. And then on the other side of the theological swimming pool, the one that I grew up in, it's more like, well, that's not right, so we're just going to rely on our own science and reason. But what you're suggesting is actually, you know, when, you know, where do we find authority? It's maybe not in either one of, I mean, these places exactly. It's in that place, that terrain that is described by a personal relationship with God, that is not devoid of reason and science and
right.
those kinds of things, but also is it a place that is seeking a bit higher wisdom than we ourselves can necessarily come up with?
Okay. Can I share just one other thing with you? My almost 3-year-old grandson was running around the house the other day, my house, and he was just going from room to room and picking up toys and throwing them down and back and forth and back and forth. Finally, he fell out on the floor right in front of me, and he was trying, panting and getting his breath, and he said, Grandma, I don't know what to do. To which I said, I know you don't. So just lay there for a minute until you do.
Mm. That's great. That's beautiful. Absolutely. I think that said it all right there. There's the cave. Well, Yvette, it's been a pleasure having you on this evening. Thank you so much. I know whenever I get on the internet, I see you're speaking here, speaking there, you're doing this, doing that, and the fact that you could take some time out for us was deeply appreciated, and I hope you can find your cave time now.
Yes. Thank you, brother. Thank you. Thank you, Eric. Thank you, Morris. Thank you, sister.
All right.
Blessings.
Thanks. Well, we're going to invite you now to simply reflect on the conversation and perhaps that line that lifted out for you in the text as the band takes it from here a little bit, and then I will come back with a brief reflection on the sound of sheer silence.
Introduce the band very quickly on the piano, Matt Amandis. On the drums, Bobo Bennett.
And on the bass, Ricky Williams. Matt's going to do a little introduction for us, and then once I count the tune in, we'll be Chuck Moronic's Jesus in the House.
So God's not in the earthquake, the fire, or the wind, but in the sound of sheer silence. You know, those three things that God's voice wasn't in, the earthquake, fire, and wind, are all three are primary metaphors for God's voice in the Hebrew Scriptures. Even Jesus refers to, you know, the Holy Spirit, it's like the wind. You hear the sound of it, but you don't know where it comes from, where it's going. These are primary metaphors for the way God speaks in Scripture, in that mythological imagination, and yet God's voice isn't in any of those. So in other words, the passage is trying to suggest that God's voice came in none of the expected ways, but in a very, very unexpected way. And then the sound of sheer silence, or another translation has been the sound of the still small voice. The Hebrew there actually is untranslatable. At least, well, it's translatable, but just it's ambiguous what it means, because the Hebrew literally means the sound came in finely powdered silence. Finely powdered silence. And you think, well, what's that? Years ago, Walter Brueggemann, an Old Testament scholar, suggested that finely powdered silence is a bit maybe like the sound of freshly falling snow. You don't hear the snow falling on the ground, but even if you can't see, you can actually perceive that snow is falling because it subtly changes the acoustics of everything around it. Yeah. And perhaps that's, you know, when we find our own cave, and perhaps, you know, if you take that question that you identified at the front of the episode and kind of explore that this week, you'd be looking in the world, the music you hear, the conversations you have, the books you're reading, what have you, the sights you're seeing. Is there something, an insight that kind of, that clicks something into place where it just subtly changes, you know, your perceptions of everything around you? That sense of knowingness that Yvette talked about earlier. Look for that. And of course, we're reminded also of this meal in that kind of unexpected place where God comes. And at the end of every episode at Darkwood Brew, we like to share communion with each other, invite you to join with us. If you have juice and crackers or bread and wine at home, we invite you to get that out and join us. But we're reminded of 2,000 years ago, a deep insight that shifted our perceptions of the way things work with God, that came from a very, very unexpected place. And given that this was a passage that came up, the sound of sheer silence, I'm not going to do the usual introduction to it. I'm just going to... Let us share the gifts of God. Have all kinds of amazing people like Yvette on our series in the upcoming weeks. Next week, for instance, we have Jack Levison, who is a professor at Seattle Pacific University, has written a number of works on actually the Holy Spirit, and is really good about addressing that. Is it the Holy Spirit talking or just the pizza I ate? So we're looking forward to having him upcoming. Also, we have people like Bruce Epperly, who's a professor at Lancaster Theological Seminary, and Felina Hewerts, who is with The Word Made Flesh. Her husband, Chris, was on the program a few months ago. She's an amazing person who's written also on the spiritual path. People like Doug Padgett with Solomon's Porch, etc. So it's really going to be a great series. We look forward to the coming weeks spending them with you. And now, my friends, until that time, may the Spirit of the living God, made known to us most fully in Jesus Christ our Lord, go before you to show you the way, go above you to watch over you, go behind you to push you into places you may not necessarily go yourself, go beneath you to uphold you and uplift you, go beside you to be your constant companion, and dwell inside you to remind you that you are surely not alone, and you are loved, loved beyond your wildest imagination. And may the fire of God's blessing burn brightly upon you and within you, now and always. Amen. 1, 2, 3.